Lupin Pharmaceuticals in association with Higher Secondary Principals Forum.
Good day, students. I welcome you all to this English lecture series by Prudent Scholars. My name is Priyanka Pednekar, teacher in English at Saraswat Vidyalaya's Purushottom Walawalkar Higher Secondary School, Mapusa. Here up on the screen, you can see some popular quotes that have been offered to us by an equally popular personality. A personality who has added revolutionary pages to the Indian history. A personality who has earned him a title, the father of our nation. I'm sure you all must have guessed it right by now. I am referring to none other than our very own Mahatma Gandhi. So, in today's session, we are going to learn something more about the relentless efforts of Mahatma Gandhi for India's freedom from British rule, as well as the teachings of Mahatma Gandhi that are of utmost importance for a meaningful survival. And we will understand all this through the snippets from Gandhiji's life experiences as expressed in the lesson Indigo by Louis Fisher from the prose section of your English textbook Flamingo. Students, I hope you are ready with your writing book as well as your English textbook while you listen to this explanation. Before we begin our journey, let us have a look at the roadmap. We will begin by acquainting ourselves with the author, followed by understanding the background to the story, after which we will have an insight into the lesson, and simultaneously we will look at some new words and their meanings. As we move to the closure, we will have a recap in the form of a summary, and lastly important, we will look at some question and answers. Beginning with the author, this is Louis Fisher. He was born in the year 1896 in Philadelphia, that is in United States, and he went to his final abode in the year 1970. Louis Fisher made a career as a journalist and wrote for the New York Times, the Saturday Review, and for European and Asian publications. He was also a member of faculty at Princeton University, that is in New Jersey, again in United States. Among his works include The God That Failed in the year 1949, Life of Mahatma Gandhi in the year 1950, which was the basis for the Academy Award-winning film Gandhi in the year 1982. He also wrote on Life of Lenin, which won the 1965 National Book Award in History and biography. This lesson is an excerpt from Louis Fisher's book, Life of Mahatma Gandhi. An excerpt, as you all know, students, it is a short extract from a larger piece of writing. Now, this book has already been reviewed as one of the best books that are ever written on Life of Gandhi by the Times Educational Supplement. Louis Fisher had visited Mahatma Gandhi in India, where he was told about the Indigo movement started by Gandhiji. Thus, you will see that the story revolves around one historic episode, that is the Champaran movement, and Gandhiji presents his learning from his experiences while he was at Champaran. So we will accordingly understand the lesson in correspondence to each of these following values that Gandhiji has offered. I will begin by reading the opening lines of the lesson from the textbook. When I first visited Gandhi in the year 1942 at his ashram in Sevagram in central India, he said, "I will tell you how it all happened, that I decided to urge the departure of British. It was in 1917. So here the author explains about the first interaction with Mahatma Gandhi. Louis Fisher had come to India in May 1942. He was here for a span of 2 months, and he says that he met Gandhiji in his ashram in Sevagram, that is located in the central India, as highlighted on the map. Gandhiji would give him 1 hour daily for his interview. And it was in this interview that Louis Fisher was told about the incidents that led Gandhiji to initiate, or rather begin, the struggle against the British, and eventually their departure. And he says it all began in the year 1917. So, now we shall learn about the incident that led the departure of British. There was an annual meeting of the Indian National Congress at Lucknow in December 1916. And this meeting was attended by 2,301 delegates. Delegates are basically representatives, and various other visitors. So you can see that it was a huge gathering. And during the proceedings, Gandhiji recalled that a peasant, that is a small farmer, named Rajkumar Shukla came up to him. Rajkumar was poor and emaciated. Emaciated basically means skinny, weak in appearance. And he requested Gandhiji to visit Champaran. Now, Champaran is a place in the foothills of the Himalayan mountain range near the kingdom of Nepal, as seen in this map. Until then, Champaran was a place that was unknown to Mahatma Gandhi. Rajkumar Shukla was a sharecropper. Sharecropper students were farmers who would give a part of their crop as rent to the owner of that piece of land that he would cultivate. In fact, as per an old agreement, maximum of the peasants in Champaran were sharecroppers. Rajkumar Shukla was illiterate, but he was resolute. Now, resolute means determined. So what was he determined about? He was determined with a goal. And the goal was to find a solution for the sharecroppers who were facing hardships due to the injustice of the landlord system in Bihar. He had come to meet Gandhiji on someone's suggestion to seek Gandhiji's help in resolving the Champaran issue. Gandhiji often had a very busy schedule, so he informed Rajkumar about his visit to Kanpur and different other parts of India. Students, this is the spelling that was used by the Englishmen back then for the present-day Kanpur, which is in Uttar Pradesh. Shukla didn't lose hope. Instead, he followed Gandhiji everywhere, even to his ashram, which was near Ahmedabad, that is his Sabarmati ashram. Up here on the screen, you can see the photograph of the Sabarmati ashram. Shukla just had one request before Gandhiji, and that was to fix a date to visit Champaran. Gandhiji was very much impressed with Shukla's tenacity. Tenacity is basically determination. And he granted Shukla an appointment, and he agreed to accompany him to Champaran after his Calcutta visit, and asked him to be present at Calcutta, that is your present day Kolkata. Rajkumar appeared on the appointed date at the appointed spot in Calcutta. After a long wait, finally the day had arrived when they both took a train to Patna. Now the question was, why did they go to Patna? In Patna, Shukla led Mahatma Gandhi to the house of a lawyer, that is Dr. Rajendra Prasad, who later became the President of India. Now Rajendra Prasad was not at home when Mahatma Gandhi and Shukla arrived, but despite that, the servants allowed them inside the house. And this was because the servants knew Shukla as a poor yeoman. Yeoman is basically a farmer who owns a land and cultivates on that particular land. So Shukla would often come to meet Rajendra Prasad in order to find a solution to the injustice that was meted on the on the peasants by the British landlords. So here, students, you can clearly understand how strong-willed personality Rajkumar Shukla was. He had left no stone unturned. At the same time, in this episode, you can also see a social evil that was prevalent in India back then, and that was untouchability. The servants of Rajendra Prasad happened to misunderstand Gandhiji as an untouchable, and as a result, they did not allow him to draw water from the well because they believed that he might pollute the water source. Now, Gandhiji believed that the real enemy of any human being is his fear. And thus, the next episode that we are going to look into, we will witness Gandhiji's plan to free people from the fear. Now, Gandhiji had already started with his groundwork. He wanted to have some more information about the conditions that were prevailing in Champaran. Thus, he sent a telegram to Professor J.B. Kriplani of Arts College, Muzaffarpur, and he took a train to Muzaffarpur. At Muzaffarpur station, he was received by Kriplani and his students on 15th April 1917, midnight. Gandhiji stayed there for 2 days at a government school teacher's house, that is Professor Malkani's house. Now, this shelter offered by Professor Malkani was unusual and remarkable. Now, the question was, why? Why would sheltering somebody would be remarkable? And this was because Gandhiji was an advocate, a supporter of home rule. Home rule is basically self-rule, which meant to be in opposition to the ruling power. British would obviously not entertain such a behavior from the government servant. That is to help a person who is fighting against the British men. In fact, even the local people in that area did not dare to render any sort of help to the follower of home rule because they did not want to invite any sort of problems from the British. Now, Gandhiji's purpose of arrival, that is to help the sharecroppers, spread throughout Muzaffarpur and Champaran. The peasants had come rushing to meet their savior. Gandhiji then met the lawyers who briefed them about the situation. They also told Gandhiji about the fee that they collected from the sharecroppers. On hearing about the fees, Gandhiji criticized the lawyers for charging such high fees from the poor sharecroppers who were already suffering. And he firmly replied, I quote, "I have come to the conclusion that we should stop going to the law courts. Taking such cases to the courts does little good. Where the peasants are so crushed and fear-stricken, law courts are useless. The real relief for them is to be free from fear," unquote. Basically, Gandhiji's course of action was to stop going to the law courts as it would yield no results. Instead, he believed that the real relief for these peasants would be to free them from the fear. And thus, there was an urgent need to free the peasants from fear of British. If the peasants have to be liberated from the fear of British, we first need to understand the problem. We will understand the gravity of Champaran issue in the upcoming episodes. By now, things were pretty much clear to Gandhiji. He had understood that most of the arable, that is the cultivable land in Champaran, was owned by the Englishmen, and the Indian tenants worked on the land. Now, Indian tenants is basically people who pay rent and they use the land. The landlord compelled, which means they forced all the tenants to grow indigo on 15% of the land cultivation. And the entire production of the indigo had to be given out as rent to the English landlords. This was under an old agreement. Over a period of time, the landlords came to know that chemical indigo, that is synthetic indigo, was being prepared in Germany, and they realized that synthetic indigo was much more cheaper in cost in comparison to the natural indigo. So they no longer depended on the indigo sharecroppers, but at the same time, they did not want to lose the rent that they were receiving from the sharecroppers. Therefore, they came up with a new agreement. Well, remember, they did not disclose the real motive behind the new agreement. Instead, they presented before the sharecroppers that the new agreement was in the favor of the sharecroppers. So the important question that arises is, what is this new agreement? As per the new agreement, the sharecroppers would be released from the 15% indigo cultivation, but with one condition. And the condition was that the sharecroppers would have to pay compensation for the indigo cultivation. Initially, this sounded as a very good deal to the sharecroppers, as they already found the cultivation of indigo really irksome, that is annoying. As you all have studied in your school, that indigo cultivation would lead to the loss of the fertility of the soil. As a result, except for a few, many signed this new agreement. So the release from the indigo cultivation in return of compensation was the new agreement. Whereas the old agreement said that the cultivating of the 15% of the land with indigo and then later giving it out as the rent. Now the ones who refused to sign the new agreement, they were even threatened by the landlords. It was very much later that the peasants understood the real motive of the landlords. Post this, they immediately demanded their money back. But as you know, the landlords refused to repay. So in the following incident, we will look at Gandhiji's experience in civil disobedience and its outcome. At this point, Gandhiji now arrived in Champaran and immediately visited the secretary of the British Landlords Association to gather some additional information concerning the matter. But he was denied on the basis of him being an outsider. On hearing this, Gandhiji really got very upset because he did not accept the fact that he could be addressed as an outsider in his own country, and he made it very clear to them. Gandhiji further met the commissioner of the Tirhut division, as Champaran was a district that was under the Tirhut division. Here too, Gandhiji was threatened by the commissioner and ordered to leave Tirhut immediately. Students, we are talking about Mahatma Gandhi. He would not give up so soon. He didn't leave the place. Instead, he proceeded to Motihari, accompanied by various other lawyers. During his stay, he also decided to go and see a peasant who had been ill-treated in a nearby village. While Gandhiji was on his way, he was ordered to return back to the town, and this time he was given an official notice ordering him to quit this movement and return. Gandhiji did not put his foot down and wrote back that he would disobey this order. As a result, Gandhiji got summons to appear in the court. Gandhiji was very swift in his actions. He immediately made a plan, telegraphed Rajendra Prasad, and asked him to come to Bihar along with some influential people. Likewise, he also telegraphed the whole matter to the Viceroy. Now, a Viceroy, students, is an authority who represents a king or a queen and rules on their behalf in another country. The moment the news of Gandhiji being in trouble reached the peasants, they all gathered in support of Gandhiji outside the court. Their spontaneous demonstration in thousands around the courthouse was the beginning of their liberation. Liberation from the fear of British. The officials were unable to control the crowd and they literally had to request Mahatma Gandhi to regulate it. This incident gave out a loud message to the British, and the message was that any form of misuse of their power would lead to the revolt from the Indians. And this was the proof that the Indians, if they came together, they could challenge the British authority. In other words, the power of the masses was understood, and with this, the goal number one, that is freedom from fear of British, was achieved. The prosecutor, that is the government lawyer, wanted to postpone the trial, to which Gandhiji objected. He accepted that he did break the law because he was caught in a conflict of duties. Students, this is important. What was the conflict of duties that Mahatma Gandhi was trapped in? Gandhiji had to choose between his duty towards the law and duty towards humanity and national service. And as we know Gandhiji, he obviously chose the latter. This clearly indicates that Gandhiji had great respect for his conscience, which told him to fulfill his duty towards humanity. Gandhiji was also asked to apply for a bail for 2 hours, and he refused even to do so. And helpless, the court had to release Mahatma Gandhi without a bail, because they pretty well knew that if they had to imprison Mahatma Gandhi, the crowd outside would revolt against them, and they couldn't afford to indulge in any sort of mess. In the following episode, we will witness the importance of unity and belongingness. Some well-known lawyers, such as Rajendra Prasad, whom we have already introduced a little earlier, Brij Kishore Babu, and Maulana Mazrul Haq, came to meet Gandhiji and advise him on the further proceedings. Gandhiji decided to put all these lawyers at test, and he asked them what would be their course of action if Gandhiji was imprisoned. To which these lawyers instantly replied, they said, obviously we would return back because our client was imprisoned and he did not need us anymore. To which Gandhiji again asked them a further question regarding their responsibility towards the sharecroppers. With this question, they realized the point that Mahatma Gandhi was trying to put across. It was simply that Gandhiji, despite being an outsider, was willing to fight for the cause of the sharecroppers. And it would be such a shameful act for them to deny their help to their very own people. Finally, they collectively told Gandhiji that they too were ready to follow Mahatma Gandhi into the jail if need be in order to attain justice for the sharecroppers. After hearing to this reply, Mahatma Gandhi made a very promising statement. He said, "The battle of Champaran is won." Gandhiji believed this positive attitude of the lawyers to work as one, united for the cause of their own people, was itself the beginning of the victory in the Battle of Champaran. In other words, it simply meant United we stand, divided we rule. Several days later, the magistrate sent a letter to Gandhiji stating that the lieutenant governor had ordered the case against Mahatma Gandhi to be taken back. And with this, for the first time in modern India, the Indian civil disobedience had been won. Civil disobedience, as you all know, students, is the refusal to obey the demands of a ruling power without resorting to any sort of violence. So Gandhiji's refusal to obey the government orders without indulging into any sort of violence had proved to be successful. Gandhiji did not stop with this. His purpose of visiting Champaran was yet to be attained. So he proceeded to conduct an inquiry into the grievances, that is the problems of the farmers. He recorded depositions, that is statements, by 10,000 peasants and collected related evidences. The moment the landlords learnt about this, they were unhappy with it because they pretty well knew if Gandhiji gathered data, their false claims of seeking money from the peasants would be out. So in June, Gandhiji was summoned by the Lieutenant Governor, Sir Edward Gate, for conducting such an inquiry without the government's permission. When this summons came about, Gandhiji did not panic. Rather, before meeting Sir Edward Gate, he met his chief supporters and made plans for civil disobedience in case if he was put behind the bars once again. After having 4 long interviews with the Lieutenant Governor, finally Sir Edward Gate ordered the formation of a commission who would inquire into the matter of the peasants. The commission consisted of the landlords, the government officials, as well as Gandhiji, who was the representative of the sharecroppers. A lot of evidence was gathered against the landlords, and it was thus expected. And as a result, the landlords, they were left with no other choice than to refund the money to the peasants. They expected that Gandhiji would demand full amount that they had illegally extorted, that is forcibly taken from the farmers. But to their surprise, they were asked to pay only 50%. But the landlords refused to pay even the 50%, and they brought it down to 25%. Now the game plan here was, they believed that Mahatma Gandhi would not accept this low amount as the payment. And they realized that the case would keep on pending, and as a result it would have been in their interest. But to their surprise, Gandhiji took them to this word and settled the refund amount to 25%. Monetarily, this seemed to be a loss, no doubt about that, but Gandhiji perceived this situation differently. He believed that this is the real victory of the peasants and big defeat of the landlords, as they had not only to refund the money, but the landlords also had to bow down before the peasants. And this was a big blow to the dignity of the whites. Eventually, the British planters even had to leave the property and return it back to the rightful owners, that is the peasants. And students, with this came the end of sharecropping. Well, that's not the end, but it is a new beginning for India and Indians. Champaran movement for Gandhiji did not end at this point. He wasn't satisfied with the political and the economic achievements that he had at Champaran in the form of, peasants' issue being solved. He, in fact, looked at the larger picture of the situation and wished to solve the root cause of the problem. He believed that there was an urgent need to remove the cultural and the social backwardness that was prevalent in Champaran. In other words, he tried to prove that education is the golden key to the door of freedom. He tried to educate the people so that they can fight for their rights without any fear of any injustice or any supreme authority in time to come. Gandhiji requested some teachers such as Mahadev Desai and Narhari Parikh to render these services by educating the people. They readily agreed to offer their services at free of cost, and in fact there were many other volunteers who joined in to this noble cause. We all know, students, charity begins at home, and therefore it wasn't only the outsiders who were helping Mahatma Gandhi, but his own family members such as his wife Kasturbai and his son Devdas too arrived on the scene. They did open around six primary schools in six different villages to educate the people. Gandhiji at the same time was even unhappy with the health conditions of the people at Champaran. Therefore, he arranged some doctors who could volunteer to offer their medical services, and that too again at zero cost. And he did find some. Now, the medicines that were used to treat health issues were castor oil, quinine, and sulfur. Gandhiji at the same time also learnt about the extreme poverty of the Champaran women, who would wear some dirty, filthy clothes. And later on, Gandhiji learned that they did not have money to buy new clothes. But remember, they were compromising with their sanitation and their health. So as a result, Kasturbai, she started teaching the ashram rules on cleanliness and community sanitation to all these people. Gandhiji, as we all know, was extremely sincere towards his duties. It is evident from the fact that despite being away from the ashram for almost close to a year, he would manage his ashram financial accounts and related matter by sending instructions through mail. Once he wrote to the locals that it was time to dig new latrines, as the old one would begin to smell bad. This shows his priority towards sanitation and health. And as we all know, even in India today, we have something called as the Swachh Bharat Abhiyan, which runs on similar lines. Visit to Champaran that initially seemed to be of only a few days, apparently took almost a year to resolve. And it stood as a turning point in Gandhiji's life. Now you need to understand, why was it a turning point? It was a turning point because Gandhiji had put across to the British that they could not order him in his own country. His action of civil disobedience was also proved to be successful as a new way of seeking justice. He explained that whatever he had done was an ordinary thing. Gandhiji's political activities was always concerning the day-to-day problems of the Indian people. His loyalty was always towards his own people, that is the Indians and their problems. And his efforts were always directed towards making a new free Indian who would further liberate India from the clutches of the British. We will next understand Gandhiji's faith in self-reliance and its power. Self-reliance is a self-explanatory word. It simply means self-dependence. That means you depend on your own self to achieve your goals. While the Champaran issue was going on, one fine day, Gandhiji's follower, an Englishman, Charles Freer Andrews, came to meet Gandhiji before he could leave for Fiji Island. The moment Charles Andrew arrived, Gandhiji's lawyer friends wanted to request Andrews to stay back and support their cause of fighting against the injustice committed by the British authorities. However, when Mahatma Gandhi learned about this, he strongly opposed to this suggestion. He explained, I quote, "You think that in this unequal fight, it would be helpful if we have an Englishman on our side? This shows the weakness of your heart. The cause is just, and you must rely upon yourselves to win the battle. You should not seek a prop in Mr. Andrews because he happens to be an Englishman." Unquote. So Gandhiji said that one must rely upon oneself in order to win any sort of battle. It was meaningless to use Andrews because it would clearly reflect upon the weakness of the Indians to fight their own battles. And he believed that one would never become independent and overcome hardships in this manner. Gandhiji's reply was an indication of self-reliance, and it had reached out to everybody present there pretty clear. Thus, students, we understand that the Champaran episode, the lesson on self-reliance, and Indian independence were all interconnected. One led to the other. And with this, students, we come to the end of the lesson, Indigo. So let us now summarize all that we have heard throughout this session. As I've told you earlier, we have looked at the different episodes in this lesson in correspondence to the value system that Mahatma Gandhi had presented. So this lesson is loaded with Gandhiji's belief system and values with tried and tested experiences. It conveys to us the significance of overcoming one's fear and belief in power of a common man, as evident through the mass demonstration by the peasants outside the courthouse. We also witnessed the power of unity and belongingness through the collective efforts of lawyers to fight for the rights of sharecroppers. Gandhiji proved to all the power of civil disobedience at different levels, but with one noble cause, and that was helping the people against the wrong. While doing so, Gandhiji too faced conflict of duties, but he chose the voice of his conscience, and that was to help his people. We also learned the importance of social and cultural development with the help of education, health, that is through medical facilities, as well as sanitation. Gandhiji believed, if we are confident and wise in our thinking and actions, we can overcome any sort of problem. As we move towards the end of the lesson, we are also told about the importance of self-reliance and independence, as evident in the incident wherein Gandhiji refused to seek help from the English man, Charles Freer Andrews, against the British injustice. So students, remember, this is a life lesson for all of us. There is no point in depending on others to win our battles. We also learn about the importance of patience, perseverance, and untiring efforts. And this is evident through Rajkumar Shukla's dedication towards finding a solution to the injustice faced by the Champaran sharecroppers. Likewise, even Gandhiji too worked relentlessly for almost a year to achieve success at Champaran. So remember, students, we should not be impulsive in our actions. Rather, we have to be patient, determined, and never ever give up on our goal. Because our untiring efforts are bound to pay off one or the other day. Moving forward, here are some words from the textbook along with their meanings for your reference while you read the lesson. Now, after having understood this lesson, we will move on to some question and answers. The first question up here: how can Champaran episode be considered the turning point in Gandhiji's life? We have already discussed about this episode earlier. The answer to this is, Champaran episode that began as a voice against the British injustice had built up courage and confidence of the peasants and helped Gandhiji to understand the efficiency of civil disobedience and non-cooperation as means of fighting injustice. The second question on the line: how does the episode of Champaran show that ordinary people too contributed to the freedom movement? Answer: the ordinary people stood with Gandhiji at every juncture. They flocked in thousands outside the court when they came to know that Gandhiji was troubled with the authorities. Their near presence was enough to scare the British authorities. Moving on, question number 3. Why did Gandhiji agree for the settlement of 25% refund? The answer to this: the British landlord wanted some excuse to prolong the dispute with the peasants, knowing that they themselves were in the wrong. Gandhiji proved too wise and ended the deadlock by accepting 25% and made the British compromise their pride. Moving on to the fourth question: what did the British planters try to do when they came to know that synthetic indigo had been developed by Germany? Answer: the British planters realized that it was no longer profitable to produce natural indigo, as synthetic indigo was much cheaper, so they tried to force the peasants to give them the compensation for not having to grow indigo. The last question on the line, that is question number 5. What did Gandhiji do to remove the cultural and the social backwardness in Champaran village? And the answer to it: Gandhiji appealed to the teachers and several young and enthusiastic people came forward to teach. Devdas and Kasturbai taught rules on personal cleanliness and community sanitation. Gandhiji also got service of doctors to improve the health conditions. Students, please take note. Due to paucity of time, we have discussed only 5 questions. For additional questions, you may refer to your English textbook, as well as you can refer to online material or the Rajhans preparatory series or Sangati. With this, we have successfully completed our lesson, Indigo. Students, I hope you have understood the details and noted some important points in your book. Thank you, students, and good luck.
Prudent Scholars, powered by Lupin Pharmaceuticals.
अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस अब आपकी सुरक्षा आपके हाथों में ल्यूपी सेफ हैंड सैनिटाइजर आपका और चेन्नई सुपर किंग्स का फर्स्ट लाइन ऑफ डिफेंस